Hello. I think we're about to start. Hello, I'm James Dunnett. I'm co-chair of Docomomo UK with Dennis Sharp. Welcome to what I think must be our 15th annual Docomomo lecture, and thank you for coming. We are very honoured to have John Outram as a speaker, someone who is described, I see, on the Rice University website as a philosopher architect. I thought it might be thought that his work would present more of a challenge to Docomomo than grist to our mill. And indeed, if I can be excused for classifying his work very provisionally under the heading postmodern, it might be argued that it was precisely in opposition to such work that Docomomo was established in the late 1980s, when there was a desire to reassert what was seen as modern movement values. Indeed, for the first international Docomomo conference in Eindhoven in 1990, Louis Hellman wrote a little concrete poem which went, "Oh no, Pomo, dead as Dodo, now were so pro Docomomo." But in fact, of course, some of those who have been classified as postmodern came from a deep understanding and indeed love of the modern movement. Michael Graves's work, for example, shows much knowledge of Le Corbusier and of the painters of the School of Paris. These designers often focused on different aspects, but equally real aspects, of Le Corbusier's work. A visit to the Unité, for example, shows concrete shelves on balconies flecked with coloured pieces of tile work like a tutti-frutti ice cream, and on the roof, diaper tile work patterns. Whilst a visit to the Maison Jaoul shows the polychrome tile work of the splashbacks in the kitchen, each tile reportedly placed by Le Corbusier himself, that almost rivals John Outram's most vivid efforts. John's work, of course, amounts to far more than polychromy, and his mastery of surfaces by confining them within hollow, column-like drums is an instructive example. I've noticed that the hard-headed business and academic community seems drawn to his apparently highly personal work. It was the Judge Institute of Business Administration at Cambridge that came to him, and the lawyers who went to Norman Foster, whereas one might have expected it to be the other way around. And his building at Rice serves as a center for computational engineering. After a string of annual Docomomo lectures given by those with more obviously modern links, Eric Parry, Tony Fretton, John McCaslin, I felt we needed to be challenged by someone who, on the face of it, would seem to reject most of what we believe in, but who underneath, I believe, has a very real engagement with our concerns. Thank you very much, John, for coming, and we look forward to hearing what you have to say.
Thank you very much, James. Now, this is the first lecture I've ever done reading it out. So, I will try to address the audience, but forgive me if I look down occasionally. I think that begins it. Fashions come and go, but architecture is built. Those who wish to understand it must have the buildings to experience. Docomomo's work in ensuring that this happens for the buildings of the early 20th century is essential for their survival. It is important work. I therefore thank Docomomo for asking me to say something to you, the supporters and friends of modernism in general, about Corbusier. Corbusier is a big subject, which others have studied far more than I. I have relied on writers like Beatrice Colomina, Charles Jenks, and Shane O'Toole on the internet. In my youth, I visited some of Corbusier's works. Can you hear all right?
Yes.
Okay.
and was moved by them. I still have a dollar bill given to me in 1956 by the guitar-playing Padre of Rorschach. He didn't like dollars, but wouldn't throw it away. A curious memento. I've never forgotten one opening to a lecture in this hall. The lecturer looked at the audience and sighed. Where to begin? My inclination is to begin in medias res, in the thick of it. This is when a practitioner like me, begins to think. So it was back in 1992 when I was designing several hundred meters of internal balustrading around the gallery of the Judge Institute in Cambridge that I decided to research an idea which had been in the back of my mind for years. It was that the ancients had never used those plumpy balustrades found on Italian buildings, pregnant, it always seemed to me, with little balustradettes. Plechnik in Prague Castle had created the most fertile of these that I ever found, ripe with multiple litters. My intuition was proved by the etymology of balustrade. It was proposed as balafstion, from the Greek word for pomegranate. I found this as useless to my purpose that it was unpersuasive. Why would there be an Hellenic term for an architectural item they never employed? I suspected the tendency in Renaissance theory to invent a Greek name for anything supposedly original to architecture, like Attica for the floor on top of the entablatura. So I turned to my faithful Architectura Numismatica by Donaldson. Reducing a building to the scale of a coin rewards me because the engraver must abstract its solid forms to a composition of pure icons. Here I found only one properly plump balustrade. Interestingly, it was at the Temple of El Gabel at Emesa in Syria. The reification of this local deity, Latinized as Jupiter, was a conical black aerolith. A well-connected 14-year-old priest of the temple was proclaimed emperor by the Praetorian Guard. He took the name of Heliogabalus. Taking his aerolith with him to Rome, Elagabalus, as he was more popularly known, would drive backwards through the streets while facing his sacred stone and the receding crowds. He required them to salute, if not him, then at least his vehicle of Jupiter. I leave to others the puzzle of whether it was Elagabalus that gave his name to this peculiar way of traveling along what in Latin would be a via strata, or paved street, and how Elagabalus strata might, or might not, have turned into the name for this peculiar sort of railing. For it was not, in fact, all of this that began to interest me. I found that all of the other railings and fences in Donaldson were crisscross lattices like a trellis. I discovered that one of the Latin names for these was cancellus, and that Roman attorneys, living before the age of erasers, would cancel an offending word by crossing it out. I thought immediately of the no smoking sign with its cancelled diagonal. Then I understood why I always liked to fill my own designs for fences, balustrades, and railings with a diagonal lattice. I had intuited that these declared to the iconically aware reader that here was a cancellation of the capacity to keep on walking over the edge of a floor plate. The latticed balustrade was a barrier aimed at the mind of a human being. The contemporary classic of functionalist architecture, the transparent, invisible plate glass railing, was a blockage aimed only at his sightless, headless body. My imagination began to extend this iconic understanding to a larger scale. I recall giving a lecture at Oxford Brookes and being asked by the professors, somewhat conspiratorially, if I could explain the work of Libeskind. I understood that their students would be pressing them on this subject, but I had to reply that it had never occupied my mind. Now it seemed, some years later, I might have found an entry to his opaque texts. Of these, I always recalled one passage. It was from Radix's Matrix. In this, on page 146, Libeskind proposes that the everyday architect is dead, his body useless unless it becomes manure or kindling for the fire. It is a chilling expression from the author of Holocaust Museums. I prefer to understand that his paraphiliac ambitions were not so much personal as directed against my medium, architecture. For what are some of his compositions, if not facades covered in what I now called diagonals of denial and crosses of cancellation? I instance his Berlin Museum. Whereas in that case, to sign a genocide by a cross of cancellation might seem appropriate. But it seems peculiar to extend this to the ceiling of a student's social building on the Holloway Road. Or his competition win for Dublin Opera. Why should singing in Ireland be signed by a plethora of slashes and cancellations, meaning prohibition and denial? Was it to make art more attractive by prohibiting it? When the same sign occurs on the ceiling of Will Alsop's School of Design in Toronto, and when this habit of slashing and crossing out facades can be found all over the globe, it is clear that one is dealing with an autonomous iconic practice with a compulsively imagistic ambition. But it's also clear, from buildings as far removed as Sydney, Beijing, and Seattle, that this iconic ambition includes the coincident act of erasing whatever capacity the surface of a building might have to discourse with the mind of a human being, in any way except that of a violent insistence upon a blinded silence. If we continue with my simile of the attorney's scribe and his eraser, what we seem to have is a regression from the high modernistic white wall, where the clerk has merely used his excellent eraser to rub out the mouldings, architraves, and tabernacles of a decayed architectural tradition. Back to the ancient Roman with his stylus, busy cutting and slashing at the chaste constructivist planes of the machina habitae. What is going on? Why all the sound and fury? Just to say, I'm not saying anything. From Alsop's Toronto building, I then saw another lead. One recalls the way certain people who do not want to be recognized on television have their heads blurred out by being reduced to a net of large square pixels. What then was the surface of Alsop's School of Design but a pixel blur of that sort? This device has enabled Alsop to create something in which his windows, those dreary little telltales of domestication, have been made by this camouflage to disappear. We have moved from the merely domestic and possibly pleasing to the more artistically rewarding terror of the Burkean sublime. What is this pixelated box walking all over some old Victorian buildings? There is no need for Libeskind's professions of denial and cancellation, where nothing at all can be recognized in the fog of blur. Diagonalizing a building, especially in three dimensions, in the manner achieved by the deconstructivist avant-garde, is as costly as it is inconvenient. Not everyone wants their windows to dip and duck around walls leaning away from the vertical. Pixel blur achieves a similarly aniconic ambition at a more practical budget. Kenneth Frampton, in his monumental studies in tectonic culture, complains when quoting R. Gregory Turner that the architect has been reduced since the 19th century to an aesthete who merely chooses the panels and reglets that compose the external claddings of buildings whose budget is mostly spent by engineers. Pixel blur escapes from this sad collapse of the Enlightenment trivialization of architecture as structural engineering. The fog of blur projects a state of iconic chaos that might be, on the one hand, the final end of design, or on the other, the fertile chaos of a new beginning, or even happy conjunction, both of these at the same time. Warming to my task, I then recalled another idea of Edmund Burke, the 18th century radical who was cured of revolution by the French terror, and applied it to yet another branch of the iconically hyperactive architecture of the present decade. While focused on the phenomenon of the architectural blob, I thought of Burke's essay on beauty. He develops a physiological distinction between the calming, socializing amiabilities of beauty and the fiber-tightening terrors of the sublime. He noted that we are attracted to the round and shiny. He put this down to the congruence of such forms to the tautly smooth flesh of pubescent adolescents and the plumply rounded skin of infants. These triggered the powerful instincts of mating and maternity. These were instincts whose effect was to engender impulses of desire and the anticipation of pleasure, main characteristics of what Burke described as the beauty of anticipated pleasure. Extending these thoughts into the iconic field marked out by pixel blur and the crosses of cancellation led me to seek a metaphor that would be similarly founded in the architectural facade, or face, that most iconically active of our media of communication. What would it be in such a field which would carry the idea of the beauty of adolescence and even infancy rendered into the imperishable durability of a building? What except a facelift, eternally fixed into the bland innocence of pubescence forever? What are these rounded buildings, featureless apart from their rigorous quasi-sphericity, if not unhatched eggs, cast permanently into a mold that is yet to be born to its proper physiognomy? Age shall not dull their shine, nor time a wrinkle fold. Lovingly washed once a week, for shiny plumpness soon grows dull with dirt, these glassy sphericities can never be marked by the gravities or the gravitas of time. They do not participate in the history of the past, nor do they forward the story of a future. They are like sleeping beauties who've stepped out of the river of time and stand, naked and dripping, forever prenatally infantile. Using these three forms of face, I was able to decipher designs that hybridized cancellation and lift, or cancellation and blur, or blur and lift. No doubt others can find other variations. Some will find this exercise superficial. It is. But it is also profound, for I will seek to suggest in this brief sketch that our failure to take this subject seriously is of the nature of Freudian taboo. It underlies the problematic of modernity in 20th century architecture. These icons of eternal youth are sometimes mirrorized. This takes mirror glass a stage further than merely reflecting the opposite side of the street with slightly denser photonic power than the universally aniconic glass wall. The curved mirror condenses so that what is being reflected in the glass blob is, well, seemingly everything. The globular mirror, by showing everything, becomes nothing. It is hard to imagine a clearer image of an architecture deserted by its physiognomy. Not even high-tech, with all of its nuts and bolts, was as veiled as a mirrorized blob. There it stands, as if under a cloak of invisibility or the hermetic hat of darkness, showing nothing at all of itself, veiled in the reflected quotidian banality of everything that the unaided eye can see and the mind know to such perfection that it entirely ceases to take notice. Clouds scud across the blue gas of the atmosphere, trees wave their treetops. And all the time, the succulent blobby thing is as round as a baby's cheeks. Glass has always been the preferred facade of the iconically subliterate. Mirrorized glass cranks up the photon power. Spherized mirror sucks in the sun and sky to blast any hope of an iconically cultured life space into stellar orbit. One literally sees the stars. Added to this is the peculiar icon of the walking building. What is the meaning of Allsop's walking design studio, or Wilson Eyre's Martian invaders of Crystal Palace? One might think that they descend from Ron Heron's walking city of those 1960 archigram image fests blasted out simultaneously on four projectors as if imitating Breton's automatic writing. I will suggest a more weighty parentage. Which brings me to Le Corbusier, the 20th century architect who manifested all of the conflicts which still beset us today. He never ceases to remain a critical subject of inquiry. And I will argue his intimate connection to the aniconic fury of the noughties. His history reveals that his first ambition was to be an artist whose primary interests were directed towards painting, sculpture, and decoration. His slow reduction of architecture to an undecorated body, putatively of the essentially synthetic stuff of Gallic concrete, took all of the first 30 years of his life. It was from this point, which one may date at the end of World War I, that flow his inventions of genius. Of these, I only want to describe four. My object here is to show that each of these four has the effect of escaping from the need to inscribe the human life space with narratives mediated by icons, which is my way of saying decorative art, or Corbusier's original, but then abandoned, ambition. The first was a political act, if we follow the terminology of Hannah Arendt. It comprised the destruction of what Arendt calls the space of appearances. Others might call it, less theatrically, the social space of settlements. I have, since being asked to build in the USA, been studying Beaux-Arts city design. This is a subject that English architects know nothing about. Even Latians ignored it in New Delhi. French Beaux-Arts city design is based on a political strategy that descends from their 18th century revolution. It would not be surprising if it was therefore anathema to the privatizing ambitions of the Anglo ethos. The strange thing was to find Beaux-Arts area planning all over the supposedly Anglo USA. My brief studies of this design culture indicates that the Beaux-Arts does not place entrances and circulation routes down the central axis of compositions. It bifurcates them, bracketing a series of major public rooms, major public spaces and rooms. These dual movement routes then serve lesser spaces or plots to each side. I call these compositions weaves and characterize them as three-way, five-way, and even seven-way weaves. The effect of this culture is to bracket between these twinned circulations what Hannah Arendt has called the spaces of appearance. She argues that these both affect, as well as reify, a political state of being. Le Corbusier, in the Villardiers, drives an elevated roadway through the center of his main spaces. He locates an airport at the intersection of his elevated autoroutes. We know that Corbusier was very familiar with Beaux-Arts design culture. Indeed, it was his ambition to combat it. Some may think that this effort was merely directed at what Berthold Lubetkin once called its cream puff decoration. We can see now that Corbusier's aggression was to cut deeper. His ideal was a city of Nietzschean solitaries, a way of life he followed himself. He did not admire the associative phenomena of Paris, a convivial city, but one given to critical assessment at every turn. He was, after all, merely a Swiss artist with a project to prefabricate mass housing, and not Josephine Baker. I think it reasonable to conclude that he was pleased to abolish the public theaters of the boulevard and the plaza found in the cities whose cultures descend from the Mediterranean. Those who can recall such places will remember that they are made by the decorated facades of the buildings that line them. Not only is this public theater made by their facades, but these are buildings whose interiors are also related by iconically mediated narratives connected to the public spaces of appearance that they collectively create. Sorry about that sentence. I have tried. What? You like it again? I don't think you will. I won't punish you like that. Mark Mazzoa, in his City of Memories, allows us to understand everything about Thessaloniki except its total reconstruction by Venizelos and Hebrar after the fire of 1917. This is hardly surprising, as this iconically cultivated plan, half built by the Second World War, has lain quite moribund, with all of its culture rejected during the last half of the 20th century. No longer understood, it nevertheless remains preserved by the resistance of Mediterraneans to Nordic culture. It therefore remains physically capable of being progressed to an exemplary conclusion. My second topic is Le Corbusier's epistemological project to deny the solitaries of his city, would he, I wonder, have called them citizens, any knowledge of what they'd built. His glass towers were like invading beacons of light, whose gaze was a suburbanizing holocaust that destroyed what all previously understood as cities. He proposed to grow forest trees over their ruins and writes, comfortingly, trees will hide the great blocks of buildings. Corbusier always projects a view over far horizons of forest and mountain, either virginal or planted, as in the Plan Voisin, over the ruins of Paris herself. Not only did his Villardiers deny its citizens those social spaces in which humans reify each other, but the views from Corbusier's apartments, his wonderful immeuble villa, never contemplated, as had all previous urbanities, the works that man had built for himself. The facades, faces of his buildings, were to be hidden from their occupants, for whom, as Corbusier put it in his famous Sugarloaf Mountain crack sequence. Nature is entered into the lease. That's the famous sequence, crack. It's what I call the crack sequence. The 20th century project to rusticate urbanity failed eventually to take place. The architects of the early 21st century found themselves shorn of the fig leaves of Corbusian verdure. The so-called postmodern attempt to revive the collapsed traditions of Western iconic literacy foredoomed itself to failure. It was so much more chic to go down in bricolage before the unstoppable economic juggernaut. Postmodernism invented no persuasive capability to discourse an urbane architecture. So what was left but the enthusiasm of the noughties for our contemporary panic of DBLV, denial, blur, lift and veil, before walking away from it all. My third topic is again political. It is Le Corbusier's project to escape the consequences of building. In order to build, as more and more people know in these property conscious times, is to acquire the ownership of a building plot, which is to say a piece of the earth. This implies, as must be obvious, that one denies it, especially during the period of construction, to everyone else. It is an act of colonization, of walling off, and one might even say of devouring. It was the way the Roman army methodically ate its way into the territories it conquered, quartered, walled, and urbanized. Adam Smith, on page one of The Wealth of Nations, calls the horse-borne nomadic armies of Central Asia the greatest danger ever offered to civilization. He understood that it was this very cementation of the earth into boundaries, plots, walls, and buildings, that it was the nomads' desperate passion to burn, ruin, and clear away. The nomads knew that their days were numbered if the builders won. For to build is to impose, establish, and enforce a fixed rule upon the wide earth, explicitly and patently, forever. Corbusier in The Home of Man prints an uncharacteristically kitsch linen print of an 18th century Arcadia. He accompanies it with a maudlin reflection upon the golden age of man. You see, he writes here, by an odd chance, we discovered in a linen print which decorated the modest office where this book was written, this lusty evocation of a golden age, an age in which chaos was banished before the birth of present covetousness. He was having a hard time in Vichy, I think. And this is a very uncharacteristically Corb illustration. My guess is that he was depressed by being isolated, workless, but still pitching for it in wartime Vichy. He follows this with an even more revealing page in The Home of Man, in which he argues the curious project that captivated post-World War II architects the whole world over. He proposes that the problem with a city is that it has these buildings at 20-meter intervals. His solution is as astonishing as it was persuasive. He advises that the whole city be lifted off its site. This, he argues, would recover the Arcadian landscape, previously illustrated by his in-cupboard print, of rolling fields and rushing rivers that the city had erased by being built on top of it. Corbusier cuts the urban knot that previously tied buildings to real estate and allows them to fly like released birds, as free as any nomadic army. Yet Corbusier's idea of this, use of this idea, was, as we could note by hindsight, relatively modest. For the subsequent architectural visionaries of high tech, having jettisoned on Banham's advice their cultural load, got their buildings to take up their bedsteads and walk. The most extreme proposition was that of Buckminster Fuller. He calculated that if a city could be a sphere 1 kilometer in diameter and made of his Dymaxion kit, in its internal atmosphere, when heated by the rising sun, would lift it into the air. Martin Pawley reports that Fuller suggested that these cities could then be tethered to mountaintops. People will do anything for free parking. Corbusier's ambitions are more modest, which was their appeal. He showed a nuclear family on its way to some verdure and sport, a pair of aesthetes having a drink under his pilote, and a sketch done in India of clerks typing out bureaucratic forms for illiterates, which he captions, "All life is lived under the piloti." In fact, as one knows, his undercrofts accelerate air movements to hurricane speeds, lifting dust and rubbish. They tend to fill today with wheelie bins and parked autos. Nor did Corbusier's poetic only project a ground-level Arcadia. He wisely ignored the advice of Seneca, who castigated roof gardens as morally corrupting. Corbusier proposed an additional Arcadia at the attic level. What Corbusier could not have foreseen were the gardens of aerials, which, beginning in the 1950s, received the tsunami of iconic narratives in which the human race now daily bathes its spirits. There is a profound architectural lesson here, on which we have no time, unfortunately, at this point to dwell. For I must return you to the ground and observe that the effects of Corbusier's civic levitation was to escape from the political situation created by that act of territorial appropriation, which is cemented by building. He was acute enough to understand, because of his early disappointments, that the iconic culture that he had inherited was incapable of parlaying a truce between the people inside the palace and the people outside of it. So he just abolished, at one stroke, the argument between the possessors of the plot and that always larger number dispossessed by the act of building. Instead of arguing this relationship, as had been done during the previous 9 millennia, via the medium of a total architecture that included the mediation of ideas, he just jacked everything off the deck and let the crowds flow back again under his sol artificiel, loosely translatable as sod in the sky. He just floated his city off its plot and set the nomads free. No appropriation of territory, no problem. No need for that semantically discursive design culture which he did not have. My fourth topic is le plan libre, or the free plan. Every human being is conscious of six directions: up, down, side to side, and front to back. We are also conscious of a bubble that one might call our personal iconosphere. Architecture is a medium that deals with these phenomena. There is evidence that some 9,000 years ago, humans began constructing shared iconospheres. The six directions became the six planes of floor, ceiling, and walls. These became iconically engineered. Later, and it may be because this engineering became ontologically problematic, it was found necessary to secure the picture planes, describing views into the culture's invisible reality, with a narrative of framing. I illustrate the storyline of one such narrative. I'm afraid these sheets are a bit compressed. This is Ortho Man. This is his iconosphere. This is a shared iconosphere. And this is the framing, which turns into that. Le Corbusier, along with his contemporaries, was born into the final collapse of the Western iconic tradition. He characterized this in vers une architecture with a dismally grainy print called The Rome of Horrors. He need only have illustrated the late 19th century Style Pompier to make his point. One has only to compare the Roman Baroque of the 16th century in such a ceiling as that painted by Annibale Carracci in the Palazzo Farnese, to the Salome of Gustave Moreau, conceived in the symbolist swamps of 19th century Paris, to know that Corbusier was, by the 1920s, fighting a lifeless corpse. The cosmic pretensions of the Western iconic had begun to fade into grisaille with the 18th century Enlightenment. The 20th century needed only to raise those decent gravestones called museums of art. Le Corbusier publicly proclaimed his rejection of the painting of the salon. Why then did he not go on to reinvent architectural graphics? We know that he wanted for 30 years to be a decorative artist. We know that his friend, Amédée Ozenfant, a man who was, unlike Corbusier, a practicing engineer, taught Corbusier how to do purist paintings. We know that Corbusier effected his architectural revolution in the 1920s in Paris. We know that this was the very city that was hatching the most radical reinvention of Western art that there had ever been. We know also that it was the urban womb of an all too brief flowering of the decorative arts, which I prefer to term the moderne. Art Deco is a term used by collectors, dilettantes, and critics. Much of this wildly animated ornament was, moreover, at an architectural scale. Why did he not turn his wide-ranging genius to the problem of disciplining and harnessing all of this iconic brilliance to the task of iconography, the representation of narration of ideas? For we know that Corbusier liked to begin his day in isolation, painting and writing down his ideas, and we know that he continued doing so for the rest of his life. Why, beyond even Le Corbusier, did not even one of the interwar writers on art and architecture success in harnessing all of this formal fertility in the graphical arts to an intellectual purpose as persuasive as the traditional systems that had finally collapsed and died? What can one call this omission except a striking intellectual failure? Who else can one blame for this but the writers and critics of the time? Those who, for example, mounted the White Architecture exhibition at MoMA. They were iconically incompetent. It is they, rather than the artists, craftsmen, and even architects of modernity, who were the real failures of the 20th century. It was their job to harness the iconic inventions of the 20th century by correlating them to a narrative. It was not for them to merely advise, as did the wretched Steven Greenberg of New York, that fine art should be aniconic. Who turned out to be his star, the half-brain-dead de Kooning? It was these writers' task to iconographicize the great formal breakthroughs of the early 20th century. They failed. They failed us, the practitioners. The question to be answered is why. A contributing cause, one may suppose, is that Le Corbusier, like many contemporary artists and writers, was overwhelmed by the experience of the machines invented during the 19th century. He appeared to believe that it was now possible to escape from situating human consciousness through the decayed and no longer persuasive techniques of the Western iconic tradition, mediated by its architectural medium. He entertained the idea, which he called a machina habitée, that if one came to live in a machine, one might obtain the sorts of apprehension of reality obtained by science and so amazingly proved by machines. He offered a Parthenon made, as he put it, of naked polished steel as a premonition of the machine which could rescue the collapsed iconics of the West. Yet by the mid-18th century and the excavation of Pompeii, it was known that classical architecture was colored. It was widely published by the 20th century that the Hellenes stained, waxed, and polished their marble temples like lacquered automobiles. The Pentelic marble on which Corbusier waxed so lyrical was a good base for colors and patterns whose symbolic charge was narrational. Le Corbusier, incapacitated by the exhausted iconic culture of the West that had been building ruins since the 15th century, could make no sense of these archaeological facts. The epistemologically flawed idea of the machine as a conduit to the cosmos dwindled in World War II London, under the leadership of Lawrence Alloway, Rainer Banham, and the independent group of the 1950s ICA, into the cult of an American consumerism, which flowered in the This Is Tomorrow exhibition of 1956. Nordic high-tech was the architectural monument to this domestic prosthetic. One was led to imagine that one could reach out to the cosmos with a brown food mixer. Yet Le Corbusier himself, paradoxically, never followed the path that he propagandized with such zeal. Instead, what he did was to use the forms that he created in his paintings to help invent an architecture which ended up, as Bob Maxwell said of James Stirling, Le Corbusier's most persuasive and powerful successor, becoming all ornament. This extraordinary effort and achievement of sheer genius so fractured the iconosphere and fragmented its narratives of framing that it became useless to its previous conceptual employment of projecting and reifying a discourse of ideas. Corbusier shared this architectural technique with his contemporaries, such as Mies van der Rohe, whose Barcelona pavilion is perhaps its purest example. Mies liked to use the unpersuasive euphemism of Baukunst for his work. Kunst it may be, but never Bau, as Buckminster Fuller proved. You know, he proved what building was. It was all triangulated stuff, nothing to do with architecture. One quarter of the budget of the pavilion was spent on the wall of Moroccan onyx that Mies introduced to obscure the decadence of his iconic culture. Something that Augustus Welby Pugin got right was his condemnation of people that papered with veneers. Adolf Loos was one of these. Unable to design a persuasive decoration, he relapsed into using richly figured stones and woods. I conclude with the history of the place where Le Corbusier met his death. Eileen Gray, a reclusive designer of domestic equipment, was encouraged by Jean Badovici to enlarge the scope of her work to a whole house. This she built at Roquebrune, looking over the Bay of Monte Carlo. Corbusier visited this house in 1938, 6 years after Gray had moved out to build another, leaving Roquebrune to Badovici. Corbusier wrote to congratulate Gray. Then he persuaded Badovici to allow him to paint some murals inside it. Eileen Gray asked Badovici to refuse, but the murals went ahead. After World War II, Corbusier obtained a neighboring plot and constructed a wooden box he called his cabanon, from which he overlooked her architecture and his murals. After Badovici's death, the house was bought, with Corbusier's encouragement, by Madame Marie-Louise Schelbert of Zurich. Corbusier wanted the house and his murals to be preserved. At Madame Schelbert's death, the house was inherited by her doctor, Peter Kaji. Kaji emptied the house of Gray's furniture and auctioned it at Zurich, perhaps to pay off unpaid medical bills. Such things do happen. Then Dr. Kaji was murdered by the gardener. I say nothing. Some of Corbusier's murals were demolished by one of the masons who had built the house. We may wonder if the vandal knew of Gray's objections to them. In 1998, the house was further vandalized by squatters. It seems that the house and its murals are now to be restored from photographs. Perhaps you at Docomomo already know more about its fate. Finally, in 1965, Corbusier died of a heart attack while swimming off its rocky shore. Eileen Gray outlived him by 11 years. What does this history show? Corbusier envied Gray's dogged devotion to the mechanical minutiae of the machina ebite domestic kit that he advocated. Yet he was not content to be merely a domestic mechanic. However acutely sensitive and civil, he wanted, in the succinct phrase of Madonna, something more. He imposed startling murals of fierce color and vast scale upon the modest partitions of a small house designed, as Gray put it, to set everyone free to please only themselves. I've looked back at Le Corbusier from today, the noughties, when architecture has melted down into an aniconic fury that both reveals an obsession with the image and yet such a fear of loathing of it that it must be theatrically denied, dissimulated, and defaced. From this viewpoint, I can propose that Corbusier began as an artist with an equal obsession. But finding his iconic medium in terminal decline, he advised that all of the German schools of applied art be shut down. He and his contemporaries invented a life space design culture that could not only do without any applied art, but positively prevented architecture from functioning as a medium of iconically mediated textuality. It couldn't tell stories. He appears to have persuaded himself that this strategy was justified by the advent of a mechanical revolution that Rainer Banham signed by relegating all of architectural history prior to 1900 to that of a mere hobby. The 9,000 years of our medium was, according to Banham, as useful to a 20th century designer as yachting or hang gliding. Yet Corbusier never acted as if he believed the ideology he preached. He not only continued to paint, getting wilder as he got older, but even used his graphical researches to invent his own compelling version of the free plan, such that he succeeded instead in creating an architecture that was all ornament. In so doing, Le Corbusier destroyed most of what architecture must do for the medium of building itself, the medium from which architecture originally sprang, and on which building depends for its meaning to us humans, the inventors of the madhouse we build with an ever-increasing enthusiasm. His genius left us today with an art that cannot create the ultimate building, the city, because its architecture cannot mediate the iconically narrated landscape that humans require in order to situate our species, hardwired as we are by evolution to a mediated existence, within reality as we ultimately conceive it. I've used my few words on Le Corbusier to illustrate my own understanding of modernity. I believe that modernity arose out of an inadequacy in the iconic culture of the West, perhaps even of mankind. It was a weakness that began to show itself in the Western Enlightenment at the advent of science. Some centuries later, at the arrival of a technical civilization, this iconic culture became radically novel and inventive. These changes included, in the field of architecture, the culture of human life-based design, a taboo upon decoration, or the uses of images to mediate ideas. But then maybe the reason for this is that the project of the 20th century was to set us all free of the constraint of knowing what is and what is not real and true, so that we can just let technology get on with it and take us wherever it's going. I've shown that this taboo on decipherable decoration, which is as strong today as ever, has produced a life space design which, though it is commonly called iconic, is the very reverse. I've also suggested, in my too brief interpretation of Le Corbusier, that he well understood the importance of the image. However, such were his difficulties in solving his self-imposed ambitions that he, while professing a technophiliac eschatology, invented an architecture which, instead of using building as the means to a discourse in the iconic media of painting and sculpture, prevented their effective use. I myself inherited in the late 1950s the medium that Corbusier created. All of my own efforts over the last half century have been bent to the end of addressing the problem that he originally faced, the invention of a medium of human life space design that could mediate ideas. I taught in the first Green Revolution back in the 1960s. It was swept away by the Thatcher-Reagan years. These at least destroyed the moribund design culture of welfare architecture that I experienced firsthand in my 4 years in the LCC-GLC. Greenness is in fashion again, but only a few radically novel techniques have emerged to add to what we taught back in the 60s. It is obvious today that our problem is deeper than merely adding panamones and panels. It is cultural. Science is the most respectable use for the human mind. Its inventions allow us to touch reality as never before. We can even begin to touch our own peculiar species. What we find is an animal which is hardwired to mediation and to fakery. The infant human rehearses its capacity for grammatical construction while merely babbling. Perhaps that is why babies scream. They can feel their nice, uncomplicated animal nature slipping away from them as they are invaded by the compulsion to conceive, invent, imagine, and even lie. It is the artist's role to perform, as Picasso proposed, those lies that tell the truth. The overlooked verb here is tell. Humans require narrativity. First of all is our need for a storyline. Secondly is our need for it to be reified. Thirdly, we need to be situated so that we may, while we occupy our spirits, suspend disbelief. The first task is the work of literature. The second that of art, and the third that of narrowly defined architecture. In the end, when conceived of as a medium of life-based design or city planning, all three are to be combined. From the viewpoint of the project, which I am old enough to call without any qualifications modernity, all three today are defective. I've spent most of my energy in the field of architecture in an attempt to construct a modernized version of what I call an iconosphere. When I say modernize, I mean nothing to do with the pseudo-pragmatism of the 18th century. When this iconosphere was perfected, I looked around for a graphicalist to inscribe it. I asked David Hockney in 1992 to design my ceiling in Cambridge. He refused. So in 1994, in Rice University, Texas, I was rather glad, to invent my own iconic engineering, which contemporary graphicist anyway knows any architectural iconographies. Meanwhile, over the last 50 years, I've been collecting, and well, at least looking at, books on architecture. I hasten to add here that my first ever purchase in 1957, with a student overdraft, was one of the Œuvres complets, such as The Magic of Corbusier. But failing, as in the story by Sartre, to find the text I sought, I have been obliged to invent my own. I am confident of my inventions in architecture. They work. But I've always been uneasy at being forced as an amateur into graphics, and even more uneasy at being pressured into writing. Seems to be packing up. Mark Jasenbeck, in his excellent book on Alberti, there's a strong smell of burning wood here. It's probably overheating. I'll lift it up a bit. Mark Jasenbeck, not long ago, in his excellent book on Alberti, reports JBA as advising that architects should not read works of philosophy, as it will only confuse them. I can vouch for that. Alberti proposed that architects need read only one book, his own De Re Edificatura. There they would find all that they needed to introduce, as Jasenbeck puts it, philosophy by stealth. Sadly, I never found this handy guide to modernism by 20th century Alberti. So in order to work at what I saw as critical to modernity and now call iconic engineering, I had to become iconically literate. I needed to water a life space desert that has taken architecture a century to desiccate, crumbling every city in its path. I needed to combat the mournful news delivered at our first meeting with John Walkden, principal of the Regent Street Polytechnic, when he revealed to us, the cohort of 1955, that architecture was no longer a literary medium. We never saw him again. He offered us no further explanation. Perhaps there was none. The Polytechnic was unique in offering no reading lists. Their project after the catastrophes of World War II was to begin from zero and train a profession of welfare state haptics who took their inspiration from commercial travelers' trade literature, which was, in fact, our first literature. Hence the anachronistic splendors of 1970s English high-tech, a style already foreshadowed in the 1930s by the Germans Hans and Bodo Rausch. A.B. Warburg coined in 1912, under the looming shadow of a catastrophic war, during a conference which he organized in Rome, the term iconography. He proposed that the philosophy of art, should have hit the button a bit earlier there, a bit afraid of that one, thought it would terrify you. A.B. Warburg coined in 1912, under the looming shadow of a catastrophic war, during a conference he organized at Rome, term iconography. He proposed that the philosophy of art should turn away from formal analysis and focus on narrative. He then retired for some years to the madhouse, presumably to escape an even madder world that was blowing up all around him. I haven't given you long on that one. I leave you with a Latin tag. Pulchritudo splendor veritatis est. Beauty is the splendor of truth. Science offers us its truths. Beauty is merely to bring these to the condition of being imaginable, for the meaning of splendor is to shine. The 20th century has exhausted itself in its brilliant researches into communication. We know how to illuminate ideas. Why then do we not frame our understandings with an architecture that mediates an iconically mediated life space design technique that actually works for humans? What is holding us back? Surely it is not ignorance. It must then be fear. But fear of what? Is it ourselves, or is it knowledge of ourselves? Thank you, Docomomo, for your invitation to speak on Corbusier, an architect whom I could love for his works of genius, yet dislike for their ambition. Genius is amoral. It sweeps judgment away before its daemon. But one can separate works from the ambition, from the theory. Genius is personal and cannot be imitated. Theory can. Theory is therefore, in the end, the more important, if less attractive, entity. For theory inseminates, it mates, it propagates, it flowers and multiplies in increasingly strange forms. How many thousand sub-Corbusian buildings do we have in the deserta radieuses of the 20th century compared to the few authentic originals? But that must be another story. Finally, a small observation for Docomomo. It would seem as important to preserve the view out of a Corbusier building as it is to preserve the building itself and its interiors. Perhaps this is the utility of buildings that look out upon the sea. This puts me in mind of an aside spoken by my fifth year tutor, the late Peter Smithson, when he said in 1960, when designing his and Alison's entry to the competition for the Sydney Opera House, "John," he said, "the modern movement is incapable of designing the great interior." This must surely change. We must take decoration back from the decorators, the themers, the imagineers, that whole fraternity of the felt-tip pen that is always waiting in the wings to flood the human life space with iconic trash. We cannot fight this with negation forever. We have to acquire negation as the ground for a secure architectural theory, for nothing is more secure than nothing. But we must be able to inscribe ideas of consequence into that ground. We have to make of iconic engineering something epiphanic, something capable of reifying ideas of substance. It is what architecture has always done and must become capable of doing again. Thank you all for coming, and perhaps as importantly, for staying.
Well, thank you, John, very much for that very provoking, thought-provoking, I don't know if the lecture is the right word, but he emailed me the complete text before this, saying that I might need to read it before I introduced him, but I'm glad I didn't, because I'm not quite sure that I would have understood it, but I'm very glad to have the text now, because it's obviously going to require rereading several times in order to absorb these, very meaningful contribution. Thank you very much. There are so many points that one might comment on, and of course you presumably wouldn't hold at all with Adolf Loos's comment about, as civilization advances, decoration almost inevitably declines. I don't know whether anybody else, I'm sure there are so many questions one might ask, but I hope, John, would you take any questions from the floor?
If there's time, yes.
Yes, sure. I think there's time.
Does this work? Yes.
Yeah. I don't know. Can I? Jeremy.
Yes, John, you spoke an awful lot about the importance of narrative in architecture.
Yeah.
If I may say, sorry, you spoke an awful lot about the importance of narrative in architecture.
Yes, yes.
I feel very sympathetic to. The way in which you presented much of your argument, if I may say this, was in satire. And I wonder if you could just talk a little bit about the relationship between satire and narrative, whether they're coterminal or whether they may be antithetical to some extent.
I'm not quite sure what you mean by this question, but I'll try and wing it. I think it's obviously impossible. You know, the Athanasius Kircher in the 17th century, he thought he was going to invent a sort of hieroglyphic language so that you would look at it and immediately know the thoughts from the pictures. This doesn't work. Definitely doesn't work. So I'm not really talking, when I talk about decipherable ornament, I'm slightly overpitching the argument. I think the best that one can hope for is a system which I would call mnemonic, a system of memories, which means you've got to have the text, you've got to know the story, so you've got to have the information. I mean, I think there are methods for turning an idea into an iconically structured sequence. You know, it's a method. I mean, it can be done. I actually printed a way of doing it in AA Files 2, but it seems to be been overlooked over the years. It was called, for those who are interested, it's called Warehouse, Word House, Picture House. Anyway, so it rotates, you see, between buildings, graphics, and text. But it's a rationalizable method. Now, once you have this, you can then create decoration which reminds you of what you know. Now, of course, people are afraid of that because they think they're just going to have a bloody great swastika on the ceiling. But of course, it is possible to discourse complex ideas, and those sort of sculptures which I was inventing, and the graphics as well, they use a system of collage. They obscure and complexify and layer one idea on another, so that they employ the techniques invented by the early 20th century that I call, you know, polysemantic, a kind of polysemantic graphic where you put one thing on top of another and you get a third thing. Now, quite what satire has to do with it, I would say humor has something to do with it. I'm afraid satire is a weapon. Possibly it would be good to use. Possibly it might get exhausted, because the problem with buildings is that whatever you do has not got to become boring.
Another question, Brown? I'm not sure that we could hear that. I couldn't.
Well, you want to...
I don't think it's switched on. No.
I think I'm switched on now. Right. You want to inscribe, I think this is the word you use, isn't it? You want to inscribe an iconography again, re-inscribe. It seems to me that there's two problems with this. One is that we don't really believe, you know, Hegel said, we don't bend the knee any longer in any particular narrative. And in the mid-20th century, at the height of Corbusier's fame, there was a great deal of talk about the absence of meaning. There was the heyday of existentialism. And so basically you could say we do have an iconography. It was an iconography of negation, as you pointed out. So we have, for instance, the void. We have the grid, which distributes things evenly across everywhere, and in a sense is the only thing that anyone believes in anymore, and there are grids everywhere inscribed in buildings. And there are the ones you very entertainingly pointed out tonight, of dispersal, cancellation, blurring, formlessness, and so on. And it seems to me the problem is not so much that there's no inscription, but in a way that people are not conscious enough that they are that they are actually an iconography. They go on thinking that there is no iconography, but there is one.
Yes, I was reading someone who was researching the evolution of the brain and the speech organs, and to cut a long story short, came to the conclusion that we are hardwired to fakery, which is my original title, which was rejected by, probably wisely, by Docomomo. We just are, you know, mediating animals. So, as you say, everything is mediated, you know, even if you deny it. I mean, what I said right at the end of my talk, or I wrote today, in fact, was that we have to found an iconography on a phenomenon of negation. Anything in architecture, if it's going to be architecturally valid, you've got to be able to walk into it as an idea. Which is possible. I mean, when you make an iconosphere, you simply cover the whole thing with script. You're in there, you know. It's around you. You're communicating with it. This is a landscape which is being reified. It's a conceptual landscape which is being reified. And it's a bit spooky when it really works. I think we're afraid of it. I think we're just afraid of it. And I think the answer to that, you know, what if it got out of control? What if it turned to Las Vegas? Of course, the only people who have professional imagineers are Disney and Vegas. I, I did the, I was the architect for the Battersea Power Station for 6 months and was sent to Vegas professionally. I wrote an essay on it as a sort of interesting place where middle America went for a sort of a moderate bleeding. They lost a bit of cash and therefore they didn't have to change their wife or their car or their house. They could go out and make more money. So it was really kind of a health farm. This ignores all the people who actually crash and burn, but we're just afraid of it, you know. I think we just have to try. I mean, we just have to try. You know, the building in Rice, everybody loved it, really. Even the curators from that museum with the spheroidal iron louvers on the top, by the paid for by the lady with the French name, the oil millionaire. I can't remember what it's called now. Schlumberger, that's it. Yes, even the curator from that liked it. The only people who absolutely hated my building were the architecture faculty. They actually banned their students from entering it. The site staff saw the professors creeping about it late at night. I had to send a member of my office who is here tonight to actually go in. I was not allowed to lecture on it. I had to deputize somebody over there to do it. I mean, it was very interesting. I thought, wow, they hate me so much. You know, who is that who said, who cares if they hate me as long as they fear me? I think it's some Roman anyway. But I thought it was rather amazing. Anyway, it was rather a rambling reply to your question, but I think we just have to try, you know?
Could I ask one thing in that context? Surely an iconography that is meaningful to society as a whole, rather, is something that has to be created by society. I mean, it's a very ambitious task that you seem to be setting yourself in a way to invent a whole iconography which, you know, will be meaningful perhaps in the way that the language of classical architecture, classical imagery was, which was, after all, the creation of several centuries and a couple of civilizations. do you think this is actually something, within the scope of one person, or well, you shouldn't start, you know, in a small way in one corner, as it were, and let others build on it?
Yes, no, I think to start in one corner is the way, because otherwise we just sort of, you know, institute a national committee of iconographers. I mean, whenever I give a lecture to the cement industry, because I do a lot of colored concrete, and I'm brought on at the end of the conference as a sort of cabaret, I always tell the cement firms that they should institute a department of iconography, otherwise they won't know which color to choose. They look at me blankly, especially the Germans, who half understand what I'm talking about. No, I think we just, you know, I mean, I nearly got there with the judge, and then there was a moment of panic, which I call the fiat nihil, let there be nothing. And everything was wiped out. And with the Texans, you know, the Texans are made of sterner stuff. They actually dress up for the National Day in Spanish waistcoats and high-heeled shoes and things like that. Brooks Brothers shirts, they're rather gay. And, you know, they have this background of Western wear, which actually was invented by a Russian. The top man for rhinestone pink leather suits is called Nudie Cohn, and he comes from the Ukraine. And then they have the Mesoamerican kind of decorative stuff south in Mexico. So they're really, you know, I mean, the English are fabulously tight about decoration. There's a sort of quadrille. Whenever we get to the interior, the men go back, the women come forward. And I've never yet been able to quite do it in England, but one always lives in hope. I think the thing is to have a go, you see, really. And I don't think it, you know, there's lots of techniques, you see. I mean, one is the basic idea is not to be dogmatic, to be discursive, to put it all in, you know, to make a jolly goulash. and also to release the text, you know, in I don't know whether they, I think they have done it actually, apart from the fact that at Rice all sorts of people made up an iconography of the decorations. But they said, oh, John, it's not a problem, we'll put it on the intranet. You know, and just bang it up if they feel they need to interrogate their ceiling.
It reminds me just a little bit of Lutyens and New Delhi. I mean, Lutyens emboldened himself enough to invent a new capital, the Delhi capital, which was quite a feat after how many centuries of classical architecture. But the interiors of the Viceroy's palace were left by him with these pure white coved ceilings, like the main banqueting room. And he was reduced to complete misery by, I think, Lady Willingdon, or the wife of one of the subsequent viceroys, who insisted on having them painted with ceiling paintings on the theme of Indian life and culture, and they're still there. These huge surfaces covered with this intricate painting is actually a bit hard to take if you actually see it. But Lutyens, for all his classicism, I mean, was perhaps an iconophobe in your terms.
Yes, he definitely was. I've always regretted the ceilings. I was brought up in Delhi, and I always regretted the fact that they're grey. I don't remember these paintings. I think they're in the ballroom, aren't they?
Durbar
Hall. Yeah. No, it's I mean, it's a sort of crisis, you know. And what sort of I find so strange is that all this technique existed, you see. And if you look at, I mean, from the 1920s, and if you look at other media, film, advertising, nobody shows narrative the door in those places. I know they have a temporal quality and architecture sort of appears all at once. I think really it's necessary for one to live in a life space which actually does place one in a world that one believes to be real. I mean, nobody believes that, you know, any of this is real. It's just molecules and stuff, you know, plaster, lino. What's real about it? What's real about it is what you think in your head. And if we can't share any concept of reality, we really don't have a culture. Somebody has to start having a go at it, I think.
Well, thank you very much, John, for your efforts in that direction and for your lecture, which has been very stimulating, and certainly to me, and I'm sure to everybody else. I've got to remind you of our next fixture, which I can, as it were, scarcely mention in the same breath, but it's which is William Curtis talking about Dennis Lasden's Concrete. This is at the on the 21st, Tuesday next week, at Cowcross Street at 6:30 for 7. But anyway, John, thank you very much indeed for a really excellent lecture.